Good morning to one and all present here. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our next guest speaker, Mr. Shreyas Munot, who is the Sales Director at Dohler India Pvt Ltd. It is rightly said, people have a tremendous capacity for outstanding achievement. There are also many extraordinary capacities that allow them to become high achievers. Sir started his career with Atul Limited as an assistant manager in the year 2006, post which he joined Dohler India Private Limited as a key account manager. Due to his constant efforts and perseverance, he rose through the ranks to become the sales director and is now at the pinnacle of his corporate journey with over 11 years of experience. Sir is a BTech graduate from Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathawar University. I cannot be more delighted to share the fact that he belongs to our SBS family, an alumni of the IMM batch 2004-2006. I feel elated to welcome you back, sir. Now, I would request you to share your valuable experience and knowledge with us. The dice is all yours.
Yeah, morning everyone. Once again, thank you so much for the introduction. I just penned down topics what I believe are important. Not prepared a presentation per se. I would rather want to have an interactive session because I mean, I think the challenges as we perceive or one could perceive, as Mr. Philip just said, challenges, I agree with most of them. And if I were to go to a finance person, the way they interpret challenges are very different. At your age, sitting over here, you interpret challenges in a very different way. I would interpret in a very different way. So it could be more of an interactive session. One of the first points, I think, for the business world to be defined in a different way, or it's something which is a big challenge these days, is I think, what is the genuine business driving proposition? When you start with a company, let's say you were to call yourself, are you the biggest producer? Are you the leading marketer? Are you one of the biggest, let's say, scale of economies manufacturer? What is that which you have as your core competency, or what's your genuine business driving proposition? I think that's coming on to be a big challenge these days, because every company and every field is getting more and more, let's say, cluttered, competitive, and even, you know, everybody is innovating at a very, very fast pace. Now, let's take, I mean, everybody uses a phone. I'm sure many of you use an iPhone. Now, Apple, who knew 10 years back, is going to be making phones. You know, I mean, at least it had never occurred to me. I mean, if any one of you had thought through about that, that's a different thing. But they came in from a perspective. It was computers, there was Macintosh, and then there was iPhone, and there is iPad. I mean, they would have certainly defined what they're willing to do. I mean, you look at HP, it went into all circles. They've sold some bit of their businesses. They've concentrated on something. You look at Tata's, Tata's would be maybe a wrong example, because they are in multiple things and doing well in many of them and not doing well in many of them. But yeah, I mean, so I'm sure all of you know what drives the group's revenue are two companies. I'm sure you know the numbers better than what I would do. So I think that's one of the bigger challenges these days. I'll tell you, like, for example, I could speak from our experience. We are a leading food ingredient company, okay? We define ourselves as a leading producer and marketer of food and beverage ingredients. Now, we are going through something very similar. Now, we were producing products for alcoholic beverages. We are producing for non-alcoholic beverages. We started doing for snacks. We started doing for confectionery. We are there in bakery. We're there in dairy. We started doing services. We help customers build up their people. We train them. We are in engineering design. We are in multiple things. But now what is happening is we are at a stage. Globally, this is our 196th year of operation for the company. It's going to be 200 years. And it's a family-owned company. Every generation, the new CEO who's come in, sees the business in a very different way. And now we are almost like, in fact, I leave from here, go back to office. It's a working weekend for us. We're doing a little strategy meeting, and yeah, it's going to run over 2 days. We're trying to see what we need to focus on and what we don't need to focus on. We ourselves are trying to figure that out because, you see, we are great at several things, but obviously we're not good at everything else. And I think time has come, if you ask me, I head the business for South Asia. I know for a fact that certain businesses in this part of the globe, they really don't make any sense. They just don't make any sense. The group has vision on that, but they don't make any sense. So I still believe one of the most important point, like this year, if you see, and I'm sure we are investing a lot into people. We are building a lot of resources. We've acquired two companies here locally, investing a lot. But if you ask me, we run a startup venture called Dohler Incubation Center. We fund startups in Europe, US, in several other parts of the globe. We're trying to do that in India. We did with a couple of ventures. It didn't fly. I think we don't have the bandwidth ready to do it here in India, honestly. We as a company, we don't have it ready. So, you know, this could be one of the topics which certainly doesn't make sense. So I think one of the most important topics, which I believe is you need to figure out what is that which you want to do. And every 4-5 years, a company you need to rethink, replot, which direction do you want to go in, what is that you're looking for, and how you want to go about it. That's one. I think I'll skip the second one because somebody said technology has been spoken about and it's more related to the first point. I think the third point, very, very important, and it's something which is beyond your control but changes dramatically. Like, I'll give you an example. We have a factory in China, and we produce a lot of apple juice concentrate over there. And I mean, I would say 50-60% of the apple juice which you would drink in India, in fact, 90% of the juices which you drink in India, 95%, are all from us. I mean, you leave the mango aside, you name a brand, we'll be present. And today, out of that, whatever is apple being sold, 60% is coming from China factory of ours. Now, suddenly, no one is talking publicly, but leading multinationals and companies are saying, listen, yaar, agar wo China se hai na, aap dusre side se dekh lo supply karne ke liye. Everybody started talking about that in the last 30-40 days. Now, when we probed more, it seems some of them at senior levels have been reached out by the government to reduce the dependence import from China. I mean, I was reading an article in Economic Times just, I think, last week. I think Vivo and Oppo, they are the third largest and the fourth largest handset manufacturer. Their senior management has returned back to China. Their sales in last 2 months have like dipped for various reasons. It's not only due to this. So they've dipped. So I think that's one of the emerging business challenges. Now, how do you take care of that? Now, I don't think there is a clear, let's say, defined roadmap which would be there that you could, if this were to happen, you could do this. But something which we at Dohler do and which I've learned in last 8-10 years, we typically try to work on, and I'm sure several other companies do it in different ways, is work on security of sourcing from multiple continents or hemispheres. We have that theory. Something which we buy from the northern hemisphere, we would have it in the southern hemisphere also, vice versa. Production sites which are capable of doing same thing, and I'm sure several of the companies like IT companies, I know engineering companies have that alignment as well. I think that is something which is a challenge which comes up out of nowhere suddenly. Like, I'll give you an example. We do a lot of business in Bangladesh from India. Around a year back or a year and a half back, when this Tista water treaty discussion was going on, there was lot of animosity in people in Bangladesh towards Indians and anything coming out of India. I mean, you know, they were not, I mean, we could see it, and every customer whom we visit, senior management, they would not want to say it, but somehow they would not want to buy things out of India. So, you know, these things are unsaid, they develop suddenly, and they come in, into your face. Then the only plan B which we had is we could supply the same products from Germany or Dubai or from China. So these are the options which I believe, and this is a big topic these days, which is there. I think the fourth topic, could anyone guess it? I think that's a sudden change. I think most of you would know it. Now, how do you take care of that? So you will break all the challenges into two parts, something for which you can have, let's say, a contingency measure. And for some, you can never plan a contingency. I mean, for some, there could never be a contingency. Then what do you do in those situations? I mean, I'll come to the latter part of the presentation and speak about how could you work on some of those angles. But political stability, I mean, you know, rules being changed, the let's say, political voice being changed and the opinions being changed, I mean, we all know what is happening in US. So that's something which is really, I mean, it's changing lot of angles in different business scenarios. I think one of the big factors is climate. I mean, from a business perspective, if you are running setups, I mean, I think even if it's a manufacturing company, it's a trading organization, it's an IT company, you know, look at what is happening in Assam. I mean, how many of you are Assam here? None? Okay, good. Yeah, okay. So you would know, I mean, we have some colleagues from Assam in our office. I just heard the trains are not working there for last almost 30, 35 days. Are we correct? 30, 35 days? Sorry? 25 days. 2 to 5 days. I don't know, but I mean, my colleague stays in Kuch Bihar. Their trains have not worked for 30 odd days, last 30 days. Tracks are still submerged. So let's assume whatever it is, let's say 3 weeks, 2 weeks. Now, assume you were to run a business back and beyond someplace. How would you plan for this? Look at Harvey in US. Look at what is the situation in Bombay. I mean, were these challenges so predominant, let's say 5 years back? I mean, I don't think these were challenges which even one had to think about, let's say 10 years back. But in last several years, these are challenges which are coming up and they are hitting us almost every other day. Or every other year, that's what it is all about. I think one of the topics which, I mean, in my friend circles and I happen to be part of the Indo-German Chamber of Commerce, and you know, it's like all German companies which are headquartered here out of India. There's an Indo-German Chamber of Commerce and it is headquartered out of Pune. I don't know how many of you know it. Now, it's so funny, every other German company is based out of Pune itself, largely Pune and around surrounding Pune. I mean, like you look at all major engineering companies, confectionery companies, like if you know Mars, if you know Perfetti, they're all in and around Pune, 100 kilometer radius. There's an Indo-German Chamber of Commerce and they meet every month once, all the sales heads and the CEOs, they meet up every month. And we had that meeting just around 2 weeks back. And it was very interesting discussion and you know, there are no rights and wrongs as it is said always. But something which was being discussed is this new era of globalization or it is neo-colonization? Like Brexit happening, Trump saying we would want to have things which is within the US. I mean, look at like make in India. Yes, we are promoting what is being made in India. But you look at several countries and several areas. What means, what is this? I mean, would we call it globalization or would we call it, we would want to go back to the old days, like what is believed in, I mean, it's made in my country, what is, like you look at Germans for that matter, because I tend to talk a lot about them. We happen to be working with them very, very regularly. You tell the German to buy American car or a Korean car, they would smirk at you. I mean, 70-80% of the Germans just don't believe in any other car which is rather than German. I mean, they've always held that mindset, always. I mean, same which way you talk to any other person. I mean, obviously chocolates, we all know who specializes. But this what is happening, who would have planned for this challenge? I mean, this is a challenge which is coming up almost every other day. And I mean, we see it in our business. There's no idea how it is to be handled, which is there. I know I'm just putting challenges after challenges because what I want to do in the latter part, I just want to come back like how part one is all about what challenges which are there. I've just listed few challenges that are the thought process. And part two, we will talk about what could be possibly seeming solutions. What is that which would be required? Because I mean, something which would be of interest to you, you're all getting into your placements and I think, I mean, some would have already started or you would be getting into it. So how does it matter to me, kya ho raha hai? I mean, what is happening in US beyond a point of time or what is that happening in UK? TK, Brexit ho raha hai, mere ko to placement chahiye, next 30 days, I need to be placed. So how does it matter to me? That would be the question which would be racing at back of most of your head. And we'll come back to that in another, let's say, 10 minutes or so. Because, you know, it's all kind of related in some way or the other. I'll skip this last part because I'm sure several people would have spoken about compliance, taxation, legalities, because, yeah, I mean, that's a big challenge. Every country having its own taxations, legalities, things changing overnight, different documentation requests when you do business. There are different angles. Yeah, I mean, the first topic I'm sure would bring a smile or bring a frown on several spaces, faces over here. Suddenly, yeah, I know you cannot discuss it in the forum where we are sitting at this point of time. I'll give you an example. How does it changes overnight business proposition for companies? I'll not name a company. It's a leading liquor manufacturer in India. For them, the sale is down on a YTD basis by 63%. 63%. Now, who would have budgeted this or thought about this at the start of the year? I mean, I don't think being a sales head myself, I can plan for such a change or dramatic thing which happened in a few months' time. And the reasons being, we have been discussing with them because obviously our business kind of gets really hit. Bihar being one of the reasons. I mean, obviously we all know what has happened in Bihar. We all know what has happened on highways, the bars being shut. But I know we being smart at Jugaad, everybody's figured out 500 meters, you take it in convoluted circles and then you reach the same place. But still for 2-3 months, several shops have been shut, restaurants have been shut. Some of them are still shut, but it's taken a while. So just to give you an idea, leading multinational liquor company in India, and not only that's one company, 63% sales are down YTD basis. I mean, I don't know if you, how many of you read ET? I mean, sure you're told to read ET. Did you read a Pernorico article yesterday? Yeah? They talk about sales being flat for them as well. So, I mean, if you were to meet them, the reason is this. I mean, now that's a business challenge. Suddenly government comes in, says, yeah, rule change. How do you factor that? I mean, there is no one who has an idea on this. Culture and language, coming to the next point, which I would say, you know, it's something which I said about Bangladesh and ethnicity, race, religion. You know, I mean, yes, it's all said, we're all one caste and creed, it doesn't matter. But somewhere or the other, I mean, as it is getting more and more, let's say, intense, I think what is happening is the markets are getting fragmented. People are having, let's say, I'll give you a simple example. Let's assume there are 10, 15 of you how many of you went for a brochure presentation? All of you? Yeah, all of you went, right? Okay. Did you meet anyone over there hailing from same place as you are? How many of you met? Yeah? Like, let's say, I mean, you come from, let's say, north, you met someone from north. How many of you happened to have that occasion? Yeah? I mean, if you could just stand up. Is there an instant, let's say, I won't use the word likability, but at least that window which opens up to talk more? Yeah? It does happen. Assume, would it be the same if someone from, let's say, a different place were to go? Is that the same case which would happen? So that's the point which I'm trying to make, you know. And why I see it as a challenge, I mean, please sit, thank you. Because what is happening is, a few years back, I mean, the reason why I put all these points are, I mean, or at least I feel these are points. Let's take 5 years back. Imagine, and be in the same situation where you are. Were there so many students who are passing out? Were there so many colleges which were there? Well, let's say 10 years back. Or were there so many industries here in India? So what is happening is, as the competition is increasing, these points tend to become more and more important. I mean, that becomes a challenge because if suppose two people from the same, let's say, different institutes go, and one has a more, let's say, a window of opportunity to present and the other person doesn't have, then it obviously for the other person who's losing out becomes a challenge. That's the point which I'm trying to make. And same applies in different walks of life. You take business, you take, let's say, I mean, it's like simple brochure presentation, you take, if you were to make, let's say, friends also, I think it applies in different walks of life, so it doesn't change. I think Nest is the topic which I would emphasize and talk on most. And I think it's a big challenge, but there are a lot of solutions to it, and I think that is where you could relate to yourself, and all this would hinge or lynch on why we are over here. I'll tell you something which we are experiencing right now from our business point of view, and I talked to several of my peers in different, I mean, from my batch, fortunately, several people are doing very well. They're placed and they're at senior positions. Many of them have not changed jobs for 8 years, 10 years. Like a very close friend of mine, I don't know, you would know it, a senior, he's in Naukri.com. He's a regional head now. It's been 10 years plus, he's at the same company. A batchmate of mine from our college, I mean, same college. He's with Daimler Chrysler. It's been 11 years for him at Chrysler Mercedes. You all know Daimler Chrysler. He started in a planning function, then he's in strategy. He's doing controlling now. So we all make it a point to meet every couple of months, and we are all leading teams in different capacities. The biggest thing we talk about, the problem which we are facing, or rather, people. And I'm sure, every company sees it in a very different way. We some of the companies, like all of us, happen to be coming from manufacturing background and more from, let's say, I don't know, Naukri.com, would I put it purely IT or which way I would put it? But at least from the manufacturing segment, I have a lot of friends. The issue is scalability of people. That is the biggest problem you have. You hire someone for this level, how do you scale the person to this level? That's the biggest challenge which we're having. Because the person is suitable for this, but then when your need and rise, I mean, as the organization goes, you need people from year to year at different levels, then you hire someone else at this level, or you continue taking the person from year to year. I mean, one logic would say, gone are the days when it's a PSU style function, when you hire someone and 2 saal ke baad wo manager ban jayega, 3 saal ke baad AGM ban jayega, 4 saal ke baad GM ban jayega. I don't think that exists anymore. I mean, I'll give you my example. I was the youngest area sales director, or rather, I'm still the youngest area sales director across all my colleagues across the globe. I mean, same college pass out. Thank you. Thank you so much. But, it's like the company believes in, I mean, it's not the function of age. And there was a quote which I was reading somewhere, age and maturity and something. So it's not about that. It's about performance, what you do. I mean, we have broken the globe, is split into 23 areas across the globe. There are 23 area sales directors, including me. And everybody else is like at least 10 years elder to me. At least 10 years elder to me. So, the issue which we are facing today, we want to build teams, we have broken businesses, scalability of people. And that's where you come in. I mean, I think one of the points which Mr. Philip had mentioned, the fundamentals have not changed. If you ask, the problems have changed in different ways, but I don't think the fundamentals have changed. And I can't agree with him more. It's all about keeping it simple. I mean, the basics have to still remain the basics. I think it's all about the attitude, what defines how you're going to do it. Because I know the topic is, I put it asset liability and scalability. But what we see today, I mean, we hired last year, I think from the campus, from this campus, we took 2 students. Year before last, we took 3. We have been hiring at least 4-5 students every year. And the biggest issue which we are facing is instant gratification is the buzzword. I mean, within 2 years or 1 year, the expectation is, I don't want to be in a role which moves about going to different markets. Like, I'm talking from a sales perspective, then I'll come from marketing. I don't want to go in different corners. I mean, it's not being said clearly, but we can understand. Like a sales manager or a sales, let's say, we call it management trainee for the sales function, a key account management, obviously you have to travel. You'll end up traveling 15 days in a month. You will go from different places. Some places you will have to go in a taxi. Some places you will go in a bus. Some corner places, means back and beyond, obviously, where there's no connection, you'll have to travel whichever mode of transport exists. What do you do in such scenarios? If somebody says, I'm not willing to go, I mean, do you stop business? I mean, that's the issue which is there. And that's where the attitude comes in. People come in. I mean, at the age where you are and being the first job, second job, I mean, what is so wrong in it? I mean, I don't think that mindset has to ever be there. Absolutely not. So that's one of the big challenges which we are seeing. I mean, these days we want to hire a lot of young talent. We want to bring in, we want to groom in. But the openness and the willingness to, let's say, learn or even slog in the initial years from different perspectives of a job, that's becoming a big challenge. That's where I believe, is it an asset? Or in few years, does it become a liability? I'll give you this example. Somebody like this, if you have it and you have had it for 2 years, 3 years, and they've grown within the company to a level. But let's say beyond that, how do you scale them up? I mean, if they're neither investing into themselves and I heard Mr. Philip talking and a lot of friends in IT, I mean, they say the same thing several years back. They were not investing into themselves to train them. None of them were doing it. I mean, very few of them would have ever done it. But these days, everybody's trying to learn by themselves, invest into themselves to go to the next level. So if a person is like that, I would say it's not a liability, it's an asset. There is scalability as a function available. But if person is making himself or herself stagnant at a certain point of time, then it is more of an asset and scalability becomes an issue. Because would you all want to be, I'm sure everybody would want to grow in the career. I mean, today you join at X position, tomorrow you'll want to be at 2X, then 3X, then 4X. Everybody would want that. And with each level you rise, the needs and necessities of a role change. They're not going to be same. I mean, the problems which I was solving, let's say 8 years, 10 years back, I couldn't think of what I'm doing today. But principally, nothing has changed. If you break it down to very fundamental building blocks, the scale, the size, the magnitude, and the complexity changes. Nothing else changes. I mean, I could have been doing this much area today, then it would become this much area, then this area, then this area. Now what is changing? The people are changing. The business angles are changing. You have multiple complexities which come in. That's the only change. I think a person would always need to be humble, I believe. You would need to be able to break it into simple building blocks. I mean, to every problem which comes in, let's say there are 10 problems flying at your desk, you just need to break it into simple building blocks to understand which one do you need to focus more, which one is needed to be attended to first, and then solve it one problem at a time. When, let's say, I mean, again, I'll go back to my nephew because that's the best. At his age, what is the problem? I need to study. Mom is asking me to study. Mom is asking me to do homework. I don't want to study or I want to eat chocolate. Those are his problems, right? Those are his challenges beyond a point, I would say. You come little further in life, let's say at 10th or 12th, what is the challenge that you have? As rightly said, I was just waiting for that answer. Board exams, very rightly said. That's the biggest challenge and hurdle in your life at that point of time. Or for some, it could be my girlfriend is gone or my boyfriend is gone. That could be as well a challenge. Nothing wrong in it. I mean, it's all about a choice. And then what do I choose? Which career do I embark upon? I mean, what direction do I get into? That would be a challenge. So, you know, at every level which you are going, the challenges, the scale and magnitude changes. But I think the way you would have solved your board exams or your girlfriend, boyfriend problem or which career to choose on, I think the basics would still remain the same. I don't think there is any change in it, if you ask me. Now, you would say, board exams, how did I manage? I passed by half looking behind, half working by myself. Yeah, I mean, today what do you do? Even if you're a successful, let's say, a business manager, sometimes you have to look around what is happening, learn from the environment. I mean, see what is happening, be vigilant. See how others are doing it, learn the good things from different walks of life, inculcate those, build it up and solve the problem simplistically. I think I would only say that same would you have done for board exams, right? Jitna padhai hui, rest. College mein jaake, you manage it by yourself, right? So that's what is all about, how you would manage it. I think product recall, everybody understands. I think the scale and size of product recall is changing. I mean, every business, the last, I don't know if you read, Toyota recalling several million cars globally. And I think it's for a simple, just a nut being not being at the right place what it was. So the consumers are more aware. I mean, they know what is right, what is wrong. And the scale and size of product recalls are changing dramatically. We just faced in Sweden, there's a biggest dairy called Arla. You know, they kind of rejected, their final product was rejected from the market. You know, every yogurt has a lid on top. I mean, you all know yogurt. One of the lids from the corners is slightly propped up like this. So, India, mein toh it's very common. I mean, you would say it's all bent and this. So, we all accept it. I know you're smiling. Yeah, we all accept it. But they rejected. That was the biggest recall which they did, because half the boxes were not sealed properly. I mean, they had to recall almost, if I remember correct, 3.5 million cups. Sorry, 3.5 million boxes, which would translate into each box has some 20 cups. So somewhere around 70 million cups had to be recalled. So, you know, again, where it started off, the trigger point was a consumer complaining. I mean, a select group of consumers complained in one store. So that's what, I mean, again, I would say it becoming a big challenge, because consumers themselves are very vigilant. We are more aware of our rights. We know what is wrong. We can take it to consumer forum. We can take it to any level. We fight with companies, and it's rightfully so. So, you know, things have dramatically changed. I see that as a big challenge, and a vigilant and a aware consumer, it's good, but equally so is a challenge, because you need to take yourselves two levels up to understand what is required in the market. Otherwise, you would be lost out in the race. Move on to the next bit. I'll skip the first one, because competitive obsolescence we spoke about. I mean, you've already heard on that. In a way, we spoke about the second point also. I mean, I believe consumer belief, let's say Patanjali. I mean, you know, if you were a Nestle marketing manager selling milk or ghee, how would you combat Patanjali? I mean, that's a challenge which suddenly came out of nowhere. They created a 10,000 crore business environment, and just based on belief that everything which comes from Patanjali house is like purest, safest, best, which is what is there. So in a market scenario, companies are coming in. That's what I was trying to say. The market space is getting very, very cluttered. I mean, then every company is looking for a unique proposition on which they can drive their business. And you just, it's a challenge from every quarter. Now, who would have thought? Dabur would have thought, Nestle would have thought, who would have thought a local, let's say, Baba only, I'll have to say, in a simpler sentence. I know Baba is a word which is very difficult to be used these days. Everybody smokes, but could create an empire out of nowhere for 10,000 crores and challenge the best of the companies, multinationals, and put them on the mat. Dabur Honey, which used to be the single biggest seller, I mean, they were really struggling for the volumes when Patanjali was pushing their volumes. So, you know, how would you plan for such a challenge? So, that's why I say, like, consumer belief, ethnicity, I wouldn't say ethnicity, consumer belief is a big challenge. I mean, if you don't build it up in the right context, and who could have planned it? The best of best marketing minds couldn't have planned someday company like X could come in and beat, I mean, everyone from this. And then, yes, everybody went back to the drawing boards. They redid it. I don't know if you've been tracking it. Just, I think yesterday it was in news. Patanjali, I mean, I don't know what a right or wrong. I'm just going by the news. Amla juice has been pulled out from the market. It's not been, it doesn't conform to the standards what they claim it's there on the pack. Now, everyone is going back. If you see market shares of honey for Dabur, it is again picked up, but first 3-4 months were bad. So they went back to the drawing board to redraw the strategies. How do they want to sell across? Like, what is honey famous for, or what was the unique driving proposition? So they all went back. It's a challenge. Again, the point which I'm trying to make is adaptability is the point. If you would have noticed last 3-4 points, adaptability. How do you adapt? How do you understand what is the market requirement? There would be every challenge would coming in. Again, I'll take it back to the simple fundamental thing which I said, simplicity. You need to be humble enough to understand that it's a challenge which is coming, which has put you on a mat, which is taking steam out of your business. Now, if one is to be arrogant about it, one is not to even accept it, then I think the obvious is obvious. I mean, there's nothing which can change anything. It would be a time before, like happened to Nokia also, right? I think there would be a certain amount of arrogance. We are what we are. They didn't see the future, or they couldn't think about it. That's why it never changed. But smart people would be those who are humble enough to accept, yes, somebody has come. They are better, faster, leaner. I mean, obviously, consumer likes it. Let's respect it. Let's go back and go back to the drawing board and build up on that, what we could possibly counter it with, or we could do it. And again, it's the point about being simple, humble, adaptability. I mean, and I would relate it back to you. The point which I'm trying to say is, like, when you get placed, and I mean, that's the most important thing, which I think I will digress from the topic. I think adaptability is the key these days. I mean, and it was said that a person from HR could get into sales, sales to HR or finance. But principally, one is likability, and I'm sure above all, the person would have been adapted to the environment which has been there. I mean, there could be different reasons. One is choice. The second is maybe there are better opportunities in a different space. I mean, you never know. So adaptability is a key which you would need to have to encounter challenges. The last one, I'm sure several of us face it, means from the industry, and this corporate expectation versus business reality, and every multinational company, I think, goes through that. I mean, something which I keep hearing every senior management meeting when we all have it back in Germany, India being 1.2 billion people, sales is X. Assume if you were to have penetration up by 5% more, your business would double, triple, something of that sort. We do business I mean, our per capita juice consumption in India is the lowest, even in South Asia, it's only 2.1 liters. Even a country like Bangladesh is 4.3 liters. So it's said that if we were to get to Bangladesh level, our business would be double. Now, you know, it's very easy to sit on a PowerPoint presentation and to make Excel lines and charts, and I call it simple extrapolation, which is the biggest buzzword which is there. It's very easy to draw those numbers and say, yes, it's doable. But that's one of the biggest challenges which is there, like, which is a reality. Is this what is possible? One is to say on a PowerPoint, yes, could you just double it? Or could you have 100 million more people drinking a juice? But is that really possible? I mean, you could say, well, how does it relate to us? I mean, what's the challenge in it? I think the challenge is knowing the market. Challenging is understanding your business. Challenge is, again, being alert to your environment and seeing. I mean, and I'll give you an answer for this one, for example. I mean, and I have a theory which I keep battling with our management. You know, we as Indians, typically when we get up, there is something called as compulsive consumption and impulsive consumption. Compulsive, by default, hume chahiye hi chahiye. Impulse is impulse, right? Everybody understands that, correct? Now, compulsive, how many of you get up in the morning and drink juice? I mean, you're all, I mean, 25, 28. So, okay, one, you are a customer. Two, three. So out of this room, I don't even see 10 hands, okay? I don't even see 10 hands. And you are the next big consumer of the segment. Now, 10 hands, now that's where the challenge is. We as Indians, typically we want a morning cup of coffee or cup of tea. That's the, or milk for that matter. Now, you can't have the European fundamental thing of saying that I will sell morning breakfast glass of juice. So that's where the difference comes in, and that's a big challenge, which is corporate expectation versus business reality. And you can only counter that by knowing your market. I mean, again, it's simple, knowing your customer, demographics of your customer, preferences of a customer, it's again that. That's the only point which is there. I think I'll leave it on that because everybody understands the market trends are changing rapidly. I mean, look at smartphones, X feature comes in, next day there is a new feature coming in. So if a company is slow to react, obviously you're out of the market. I mean, you look at cars, every I would say third week, fourth week, there's a car which comes in with a new feature. I think if you would have read yesterday's ET or day before's ET, I don't know, Verna, I mean, car which you all see on the streets, it's all going to be produced in India and exported for the world. But I don't know how many of you know it. But the point which is not there in the article, and if you were to Google a little more, the Verna which has come in new, some of the features being given in that segment of the car are not even there in the segment of most of the cars which are priced twice that of that car. I think Verna would be, I don't know the cost, but somewhere between, let's say, 10 to 15 lakhs, 13 lakhs, thank you. So some of the features which are in that car are not even in the cars which are in the segment, I mean, of 25 to 30 lakhs. Now imagine what would happen very soon. I mean, very soon, Verna would start advertising that big time, Hyundai would start advertising it, and they would start eating into the share of other cars. So from the segment which they're playing today from 10 to 15 lakhs, they would slowly expand it very quickly to 10 to 20 lakhs. And they launch a premium version and they keep, so you are in this market, but very quickly you expand and take on both sides. So you know, that's about fast changing market trends. Now if I were another car manufacturer, I would need to be realistic and aligned about it, very quickly adapt to it. See, okay, is it possible, not possible, doable, not doable, And either I attack the market with a counter proposition, or I see, okay, this is not doable, I need to do this. So that's what I mean by that. But that's the last point which I have on the slide. But the summary of all this, what if you were to relate to it, and then the present time where you are in, I would only focus on two, three things. It's every challenge is a challenge. Now, there would be two types of challenges which I said. One, which you can plan for. Second, which you can never plan for. There's nothing. But for whatever challenge it is, you only need basically four things. First, I think most important, I believe, one has to be humble. To accept the reality, whichever way it is. If you are arrogant about the situation, I don't think it helps at all. The second is to make it very simple. I think break it into building blocks, attack the problem, see the problem, solve it. The third being very, very agile and aware of the surroundings and the situation. And the last but not the least, which I believe big time, is adaptability to a situation. I think being adaptable to different environments is the key. Now, if you were to say, how does it relate to it? I think yes, you're going to pass out with MBA, or Pgdm degrees, but please don't go with the mindset, I'm a manager. I would sincerely request that as an alumni, and I would say yes, as a fairly successful alumni, I would say that with all due respect, to all my colleagues and everyone. But I think what really made the difference is to be not going as a manager, because if you step into an organization from day one using with that golden hat which you have that I'm the manager, I think you have made the first biggest mistake of your life, or a corporate life, I would say. I think please go in with a perspective that yes, I have learned, but let me get into the surroundings, be more, let's say, vibrant, see what is happening, and soak in as much as I can. Be a sponge. I keep telling it to our team and whosoever joins us, if you have to be first few years, you have to be a sponge. Keep soaking in the environment, understand what is the good things, take it into your system, and you keep delivering when it is required. I think that has to be the only clear focus for first few years when you get in. But don't go by with this preconceived notion that I'm a manager, I'm only supposed to do this. There is nothing called as a manager level job, there is nothing called as a low manager level job, executive level job, I don't know what below would be there. Because when I was in between my career, I was RM for a North office, I used to go to the office, open the office in the morning. I used to clean our own tables when there is no IT setup which is there, so you are the IT person, you are everything. I think that's what I believe in, principally if you ask me. And any challenge which comes in, principally, whether it is emerging business challenge, life challenge, it's all about breaking into basics and then operating on them. That's it from my side for today. Thank you.
The house is now open for question and answers.
Yeah, before that, I'll just say, this is my interpretation. I don't know, good, bad, ugly, which way is it? Because I'm sure you would hear from lot of very expert speakers, their take, much more detailed take. What I thought was something which I see in my walk of life and something which you could relate to, put it up on the table. Please ask if there are any questions.
Sir, my name is Saket Upadhyay. I'm from BIMM. So,
sorry, what's your name?
Saket Upadhyay.
Yeah, hi Saket.
So, sir, this question is then related to the decrease in consumption factor of the aerated or carbonated drinks. So, with the decrease in carbonated drinks, Coca-Cola and all the other companies have started moving into making more juices and all. So, since you are also, since you supply a lot of sweeteners and ingredients to all those juice-making companies, so, marketing team would be having some designated role of planning all those activities for promoting the company, Dohler. But since you are into a B2B business and you do not project much of advertisements, how is the sales team going to plan it accordingly so that right now, since the demand is going to increase, the sales team and all the entire team of Dohler is prepared well?
So, what is
the exact role of sales team over here going to be? Can you focus over there?
It's a long question. Let me get the comprehension correct. So basically, you're asking how would the sales team plan for the anticipated or rather the decrease in the sales which is happening. Am I correct?
For the anticipated increase in the consumption of juices and all. So because there is a decrease in the consumption factor of carbonated drinks and because of that, all the other companies have started going into the juice making business a lot. Even Coca-Cola, got this news saw this news recently that Coca-Cola is going into a lot more of the juice making business. So How is Dohler going to like prepare?
So I'll answer that. So how we are doing? We are doing in 2-3 ways. Means one is again, it's something which India had to go through. I mean, the aerated beverages sale in India is growing at around 8.5%. Sit. 7-8%, which is by global standards not really bad. It's still great. But the writing on the wall is very clear. I mean, you know, Coke typically defines as a regular Coke drinker somebody who drinks 2 glasses of Coke in a week. Okay, so India, I mean, I think not even 10-15% of our population quantifies to that level. So one is to be worried of the big discussion which is there, but the reality is also that now, I mean, you leave the towns, okay, and I'll break this question into 2 parts. Is the threat really a threat, first of all, because we keep having this discussion. I mean, you go to a village. I mean, what is like sugar and aerated harmful discussion? It's all about, I mean, thanda hai, garmi hai, main pee raha hoon. Very simple things. I mean, you know, that is what it is. And you know, where like, let's say, I don't know how much is the number right now, you would have a better handle. Where there is a significant number of the population which is starving for nutrition, would you call sugar a bad thing or a good thing for them, which would give them instant energy? So, you know, I still believe the aerated beverages market would grow reasonably well. But the way we are preparing ourselves, we are into juice-based products for a while. So, you know, how we do it is we see this and we are rolling it out, very customized product offerings for the market. We're also into, so we work in 2 ways. We work with the R&D and the marketing of a company very, very closely. We keep doing concept workshops. We do it twice in a year with them, where we take them through different concepts, present and futuristic. And this happens every year. So we've been working on this for the last couple of years. So most of the companies are already ready with their offerings. So it's a matter of time when they'll start launching it. We have dedicated product manager team. They work on this, pulling from a global pool what concepts could work. And they also work with the R&D to develop concepts which could be localized in terms of, let's say, taste, preferences, acceptability, because that would be. Is that answering your question or?
Excuse me, sir. My questions are based on your last 2 points. The first question is, sir, the German companies are known for innovations and the company is focusing on the new products and solutions, so you must be needing the product insights or the market insights for the development of new products. So for this insight, you resort to the external firms, or do you do it internally, or does this come from the global headquarters, that is Germany? And the second question is, sir, in industrial value chain, you are not closest to the end consumers, right? So for your products or for your market insights, you resort to and you focus on this customers or the companies who produces the product for this consumers?
I'll answer both of the questions. Very interesting question. But I must say, I mean, when we were sitting on those benches, we couldn't even ask these quality of questions. So obviously, you guys are far better who are there today. I must compliment largely on that.
One more thing. There are like products coming like gluten-free or vanilla. Talking about, because vanilla, you must be knowing that artificial vanilla is more feasible than the natural vanillas, which are not available in the market.
I think I'll answer the first 2. You hold the 3rd one because I'll forget otherwise. So the first question, we use a mix of all 3. To answer your question, we go by market insights. We use different market research agencies. We go by our own interactions. So we partner with a lot of other B2B companies. We ourselves conduct focus groups, or we rather invited to them. Customers invite us for their focus groups and interaction with their consumers. So that's the direct first-hand information which we get. And the last is we also use a lot of knowledge from our headquarters, because they have seen through it, you know, learnings from a developed market into a developing market. All 3 we are using. All 3 is being in fact used. That's the first one. The second question, if I remember correct, is more about we being a B2B company, we being distant from the consumer. How do we react to what is the preference, or do we go by the consumer company?
No, exactly. Do you focus on the consumer directly, or do you focus, because depending upon the consumer, the producers will do, and depending on the producers, you will be doing your business, right?
So, exactly. So that's the difference where the consumer and the customer difference comes in. So we do mix of both. We partner with our customers and thereby map the consumers. You know, like in India, we've gone to the extent of understanding region-wise, what is the sweetness acceptability limit? Just to give you an idea, like eastern part of India, likes everything much sweeter than what, let's say, southern part of India likes it. The preferred taste, the preferred beverage matrix, we've gone to extent of mapping it. Obviously, we have not done it by ourselves. We have done it with our customers. So we work with them in close tandem. So they see us as their stakeholders and their partners in the process. And sometimes we do it directly also. I mean, we have our own, we said we have three businesses. So we operate via the other business where we are directly working with very small time manufacturers, which gives us a real feel of the direct consumers also. Like somebody who's making, I mean, you know, roadside beverages, they also need to buy a flavoring. We produce a flavor. So it gives us direct insight also from the sales. You had a third question.
Yeah, third question was that, so the health factors are coming to play in the newer markets. The thing is, products like gluten-free products, vanilla, which goes into non-alcoholic or alcoholic beverages or confectionery market. So do you focus on these products, that gluten-free, which is coming into market now?
I mean, tell me honestly, you know, this is a big discussion which keeps happening. How many of us, or rather even you, I mean, I'm not ridiculing out, what is this gluten as a concept in India? You know, I mean, these are all developed markets buzzwords. Yes, we are focusing to answer your question. We are prepared for it. But again, I break it into very fundamental, simple things in a country where there is nutrition, where there is taste, where these are two major driving challenges, like lactose intolerance. Now, I think several of us have it. I mean, many of us are lactose intolerant. Do we even know it? You know, it's all about knowing the right things. We have not reached that level of understanding of the market to break it into so many blocks and then see. I think this would be the next age, or that would be one of the challenges which would be there in future. And we keep discussing, like, when the market reaches this level, what is the offering which is ready? So I think the offerings are all there. It's all about timing into the entry of the market. That is there. But believe me, there is extra hype about that rather than realistically any necessity of it being there. Honestly, if you ask my personal take on that, very personal take.
Thank you, sir.
Afternoon, sir. Sir, as you may introduce yourself as a sales guy, so I would like to know your approach towards the most common question asked in job interviews. Look, on that question, you judge the capability, generally judge the capability of person, that is, sell me this pen. How do you approach this question?
Very, very good question. We also ask it several times. First of all, I mean, you know, I was here for GDPIs last year and year before last. I would tell you to be honest, okay? I would not ask you to stage anything. I mean, it's very personal belief, whether it is a GD or a PI, be absolutely honest. Now, I'm not asking you to say this pen is lousy, I'm not going to sell it, this is stupid pen. Obviously, don't say that. But when I say honest, go from what you would firmly believe in. Let's say, if you're wearing this tie, why would you wear that tie? I mean, what genuinely you like, go from that. I mean, and I think, I can't answer for you, and I'm being honest, what is the right answer for this question? Because it's all about the situation, the moment, who's asking you, what is being asked, what product is to be sold, there are several variables to it. But I would try to help you possibly what you could do. One is to be honest in what you would want to do in that situation. And the second, I think go from a very simplistic thing. I feel most of the time what I've seen in interviews, a lot of jargons are being used, for which you get yourself caught in that trap. Somebody comes with last year, I don't recollect, we were doing interview in some college. BCG matrix will lead to this. And you won't believe it. We asked them to draw the BCG matrix. The person got it wrong. So, you know, why would you want to lay a trap for yourself in the next minute where you can be caught? Because I'm sure the interviewer will ask you, please explain me BCG model. So I would suggest to keep it very simple. Go with fundamental things. You know, I like this. This is what I firmly believe in. And if you, as a salesperson, if you were to put, I mean, the way I do it, I always put me, myself behind what I'm trying to do. More often than not, you have a personal connect with whom you're selling to. It works. I mean, eventually, I mean, in B2B business at least, it's not about, I mean, it's all about the product, but also about the interpersonal relationships which you build with the person who's sitting on the other side. So I think that's the only thing which I could answer for your question. I don't know, does it answer or not?
Or what if the interviewer is very, very reluctant?
You'll have to keep trying. Just be persistent.
I don't want to buy this. Sell me anyhow. So how would you?
So I'll tell you a live example. This happened in this college only. Last year we were interviewing a girl from CRT team. So I'm a backbencher. I've I've slept half the thing. So I kept telling her, what have you learnt? I was challenging her. I knew she would have attended lectures. I said, kya padha hoga? Aapne koi lecture hi nahi kiye honge. I kept pushing at her, and you know, me and my colleague who were there, kept pushing at her. She knew it, that she's not attended so many lectures, and she admitted part, but she was not admitting it. But you know, every time I was pushing at her, and I mean, imagine the pressure which would be there. I mean, everybody wants a job, and don't get pressurized, but you know, no sir, but I'm equally intelligent. And every time she was smiling back. And not smiling back as if almost teasing it off, aisa wala nahi. But it was a pleasant sign, no sir, but I know this, but please ask me this question, but please ask me this. So you know, when the person is challenging you, never ever challenge the person back at the same moment. I would request that, or rather suggest that. I think what you could do is, sir, this is what I believe, this could be this advantage, why don't you try this? Come with options to the problem or the resistance which is there. You know, what is the problem? Means, what do you think is the issue? Do you think this is the issue? Why don't you try this? You know, you may not be able to strike the perfect thing in one go, but if you keep doing it, I have seen it, people doing it relentlessly. The person gives his boss, I need to give this guy a chance. I mean, this happened with me, I have done it with someone else, I believe in it. You know, just be persistent to that occasion and just be polite and humble again, I would say that. And you try it, yeah, be genuine, is I would say that. I mean, I'm a firm believer in it and it works. I mean, it's, for me, it's worked, I would say, yeah, all my life, 80-90% of the time it worked. There are 10% of the time the guy is just like belligerent and he doesn't want to take it. Yeah, I mean, you have to just say, tough luck. Nahi hua aaj. But go at it again. I mean, some other place, some other time, don't give it up. And I would only say that even if it's an interview, I mean, honestly, it's my personal take, and you could say, listen, now you are a sales director, you're standing here, you could talk all these nice things. But when I sat for interviews in this campus and I could tell an incident what had happened, Bala sir is also here. I firmly believed in then, and I firmly believed, kya hoga jada se jada? I mean, this is what I went with. Kya hoga jada se jada? The only thing which I cannot is, I will not be placed today. But there would be some other company which would be coming for me tomorrow. But I need to give my best shot every time I step in. But I don't want to be desperate to the extent I'm cheesing the other person off. That's the only suggestion which I have it to you and several others who are here, because I see that and we have faced it. You know, let desperation not be obvious. Be confident, be polite, humble, but keep applying your mind is what I would request. That's the only suggestion.